When it comes to forgotten and unknown cars, most of the time they are supercars, which for one reason or another had a very limited production run. But there are some quote-unquote normal cars which time has completely forgot. And probably the most notorious car of them all is the Rayton-Fissore Magnum, or LaForza, how the car is mostly known. LaForza is quite a strange car, because despite being a totally unknown car outside of Italy, the car actually was one of the first modern luxury SUVs. But this doesn't mean that the car was any good. So hello guys and welcome back to another video, and here is the story of Rayton-Fissore Magnum. The story of Rayton-Fissore begins in 1976. Carrozzeria Fissore is one of the lesser known Italian coach builders. For most of the time they didn't design cars but built and repaired bodies for different brands. Their most known designs were done for Di Tommaso with the Vallelunga and for the Swiss of Monteverdi with cars like the high speed 375L and the Safari. In 1976, Fernanda Fissore, the daughter of Bernardo Fissore, one of the founders of Carrozzeria Fissore, together with her husband, Giulio Malvino, founded Rayton-Fissore. For unknown reasons, they decided to create a new company and not to continue with the Carrozzeria Fissore. They took the name of Fissore, probably for more notoriety, while the Rayton meant nothing. Meanwhile, in 1980, Iveco presented a new truck for the Italian army. This was the Veicolo Multiruolo, VM90. The truck was based on the Iveco daily platform, just with some tweaks, such as a shorter body for better off-roading and a four-wheel drive system, which later also became available for the civilian models. And would be this civilian model that would become the basis for the Magnum. Now, the car had to be totally different from all the other off-road vehicles of the time in order to succeed. Range Rover was the only luxurious off-roader at the time, while Monteverdi Safari, like the International Harvester Scout upon the Safari was based on, was going towards the end of its production, while LM002 was still a military vehicle at this point. The designer of the car was going to be Tom Ciarda. Ciarda was quite an established designer, with some legendary designs under his belt, with such cars as the Ferrari 330 GT 2+2, Fiat 124 Spider, Ferrari 365 GT California, Di Tommaso Pantera, and the Lancia Y10. The design of Ciarda looked totally different from all the other off-roaders of the time, since it was ditching the strong lines for more curvy and softer ones. But the most important part is that the car looked more like a lifted up hatchback and not like a typical off-roader. For so much the car looked like a lifted hatchback that later would receive the nickname La Uno Gigante or the Giant Uno, referring to the Fiat Uno. Now, of course, the Iveco platform received some changes, with the main one being the length and the height. The rest was mostly the same as on the Turbo Daily, with some minor changes here and there. Now, there was quite a good reason for so many Iveco parts. The original idea of Rayton-Fissore was to build a car for Iveco. They showed a prototype to Iveco, but it was rejected, and Iveco said that they made trucks and not cars. Then the prototype was shown to Fiat, where it was yet again rejected, because Fiat made cars and not trucks. So, with both Fiat and Iveco out of the picture, Rayton decided to go on its own and to build the car themselves. And probably with this changed the Magnum into a luxury upscale SUV. The car was dressed with thick Italian leather and wood and also had basically all the high-end options of the time, in similar style with Ferraris and Maseratis of the time. The Rayton Magnum made its debut at the 1985 Torino Motor Show. Originally, the car was available with three engines, with two petrol and one diesel, with a 2.5-liter V6 Alfa Romeo engine being the premium one on the version which was known as the Magnum VIP. After the presentation, Rayton started immediately the production of their new 4x4. First, the body panels were made by Golden Car from Caramagna. This Scotch builder later would also build the bodies for the Lamborghini Diablo. After that, the bodies were sent to Savigliano, where the Rayton-Fissore offices were located, and where the final assembly took place, while in 1988 the company moved to Carrasco. Also, in 1988, the Fiat and the Alfa engines were replaced by VM Motori and BMW engines. Besides offering the car to civilians, Rayton also was looking to sell the car to the Italian police and army, and they managed to strike a pretty good deal with both of them, with only the Italian police ordering 1500 cars. But this just wasn't enough for Rayton. They needed the civilian sales no matter what in order to succeed. And due to the large displacement, the car wasn't selling that well in Europe. But things started to look a bit more promising when the car made its debut in America, where two Californian businessmen by the name of Robert Oliver and Joseph Monterosso sat on the threshold of the car and thought that it was perfect for the American market. So they created La Forza Automobilis Incorporated, which means the force in Italian. In order to comply with the American regulation, the car received some changes, like plastic bumpers, while the front and the rear were completely redone. And then more than 50 different changes were made to the exterior and the interior design of the car. Also, the European engines were replaced by Ford V8s. Monterosso managed to strike a deal with Andrea Pininfarina on assembling the bodies at the facilities of Pininfarina. Around this time, Pininfarina was also building the bodies for the Cadillac Allante and the Ferrari Testarossa. After this, the semi-finished bodies would be sent to America for the final assembly. But again, the car proved to be a failure. From 1988 to 1990, only 120 LaForzas 5.0s were sold. The main reason for this was the high asking price, which was over $48,000, which was way more expensive from off-roaders like Bronco, the Grand Wagoneer or the Pathfinder, while the car couldn't compete with off-roaders like Range Rover, which had way more history behind them. And so in August of 1990, Monterosso announced the liquidation of the company. A year later, a company from Saudi Arabia bought out for $3.5 million the name rights and also the stock reserve, which was about 300 bodies and chassis. But again, no one was showing interest about the car. In over 3 years, only 150 cars were sold in Saudi Arabia. By 1993, the Saudis were the only ones who were building the car, since Rayton-Fissore had gone bankrupt. But in 1994, a Californian businessman by the name of David Hopps started negotiation on buying the brand from the Saudis. Hopps was the owner of Monster Motorsport, which was mostly known for building Miatas with Ford 5-liter V8 engines. The Saudis agreed to sell the name to Hopps, and so in 1995, the car made another debut at the Los Angeles Motor Show. Things started looking a bit better when Hopps took over the brand. In only 1995, 43 LaForzas were sold. These cars were packed with the same 5-liter V8 with 225 horsepower from the Mustang GT. Later, there would be a number of LaForzas with some more powerful engines, but looks like these were special orders. Also, something quite interesting is that some LaForzas came with Ferrari badges, which is quite weird how they managed to do this. Hopps managed to buy the old Rayton-Fissore factory, with the idea to enter the European market again with a version packed with the 3.2 V6 Busso of Alfa. The American version also received some updates, with the main one being the mechanical parts, which this time came from GM, since the contract with Ford had expired. Also, the body received some stylistic changes. But it was no good, since in 2003 the company had to declare bankruptcy. It was clear that the brand would go down sooner or later. Maybe in the 80s and 90s the Magnum was something special. But by the early 2000s it was just terrible. Especially when you consider that all the luxury brands had introduced sport utility vehicles. With the ML of Mercedes, the X5 of BMW, the Navigator of Lincoln and the Escalade of Cadillac offered way more than LaForza. Why this car failed? In this case, it's simple in my opinion, is that car was just bad and nobody wanted one. So guys, thank you for watching and see you next time.